We want to invite you to join us for our next in-person Sunday service. We've been taking extra precautions to make it safe and easy to attend. At our services, masks are required. We maintain a reasonable distance between parties, and we do a deep clean after every service. You'll also need to register by going to our website and clicking the Reserve Your Spot link in the golden banner at the top of the page. We also send an email invite each week, and if you don't receive our emails, text CCP Connect to 94000 and we'll make sure to add you to our invite list. We've been so blessed by our current session in the Gospel Project, and it's coming to a close in a few weeks, and the new books are available for pickup at the church, and we're so excited about these. They're normally $5 a piece, but we want to give them away to everybody in our church for free. If you come by on our Sunday services or during the week, during our office hours, you can pick up your copy. They're available today, and the session begins March 7th.
Well, hey, church family. I'm Pastor Wes. I'm one of our pastors here, and I'll be your online host this morning. We're so glad that you chose to join us for church online today. We know that God wants to work in your life, and we're excited to hear from His Word and to worship together. Before we get there, there's a few announcements I want to share with you. Specifically, there's three things coming up that I want to make sure you know about. The first one you already heard about. Our new Gospel Project study book starts next week. March 7th is the first day of it. We have the books at church. We'd love for you to come by, pick up your book. You could come during the week when our staff is in the office. You could come on Sunday morning and get it then. But we're so looking forward to this new study. The book is free for you. We're giving it to you as a gift. All you have to do is come and get it. And with this new study coming up, it's a great time to jump into a group if you're not already part of one, or a great time to start a group. If you'd like to start a group, invite a friend to join you to work through this book together, to meet weekly, and then text CCP Host to the number 94000. That'll get you all the resources so that we can support you as you step out in faith to lead your group. Also, next Sunday, we're going to be starting, it'll be the first week of our four-week small group called Getting Started. Getting Started is a small group for anybody that's new to faith, that's new to the church, or that's been here but is looking to get connected. We want to help you plug in. We want to help you build relationships with others and grow in your relationship with God. It's a four-week small group. It meets after church on Sunday here at the building. And we're going to provide lunch for you, too. We'd love to get to know you. We'd love for you to get to know us. And we'd love to help you connect to the work that God is doing. Also, this coming Wednesday, we're going to be meeting online on Zoom for communion. And through this season we've been walking, and I've loved how we can meet for communion on Zoom. I think it's changed how I think about communion, because it's not only us coming to the Lord, but it's us coming together. Just as Pastor Zach was teaching us the other week, one of our core values is Jesus at the center. He's commanded us to observe communion, to remember the sacrifice that He gave for us, and then to walk in that, to live that out in our lives. So we're going to come together on Zoom on Wednesday at 8 o'clock to celebrate that together. We hope that you'll join us. We've also got a lot of exciting stuff coming up with our kids ministry, so I'm going to pass you over to Aline, because she's going to share an update with what's going on there.
Hi, church. I'm Miss Aline.
And I'm Miss Janine.
And we are so excited to have a plan to reopen. On March 14th, we are ready to welcome our babies through kindergarten back to the Seeds Ministry.
That's right. The classrooms are ready. The teachers are ready. So get ready to come back to the classrooms and join your friends and make a joyful noise to the Lord. And remember to bring your Bible.
That's right. Seeds Ministry has five core values that are easy to remember because they start with a letter from seeds.
Mm-hmm, that's right. The S stands for sow the word of God into the heart of each child that leads to salvation.
Yeah, the first E is to enlist, empower, and treasure team members.
The second E is equip parents in their role as primary disciplers.
Yeah, D is develop a relationship with every child.
And the last S is for sincere worship.
Yeah, and you know, what we realized during COVID is these values didn't change. And if you're a Seeds family, you know we've shifted to stay connected.
We sure did. We've sent out mailings, we've done porch drops, yep. we've done park dates, yep. we've given 30-day challenges. We've done lots of things to make sure that you remember that we love you yeah. and that God's word is alive and continues to speak to us even when we're quarantined.
Yeah, you know, this pivot we made allowed Janine and I to witness God's mighty power at work. And we even had a lot of fun over the past year, but nothing replaces the warmth and love that happens back in the Seeds ministry. We're starting off with limited capacity, but are planning and preparing to be fully functioning again. If hearing that just gave your heart a little ping, please reach out to Janine and I, and we can share a little bit more about the ministry. It's really a fun place to serve. We're rebuilding our team and we'll have positions open in all age groups once we go to two services.
That's right. And church, I just want to remind you that Jesus said, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them, for such is the kingdom of God." And there is such joy that comes from being with the children, and we look forward to being with them again and watching them grow
we
and
sure
learn,
do.
And we love it. And I know that you guys would love it too.
Yeah, so again, set your calendars, March 14th.
Man, I am so excited about what's going on in our Seeds ministry right now. And I know my kids are excited too. My four-year-old asks me all the time, when can I go back to church? How much longer till I can be in the class with my teachers again? We're so excited with what God's doing. We can't wait for this next season for our church. And as we anticipate these changes coming up, I just want to say thank you right now to all of our church at home leaders. For almost the past year, they've been the front lines doing the work of the ministry in our church. And we're so grateful for you, how you've opened your homes, how you've ministered to our body, and the work that you've been playing. And I want to keep encouraging all of you as we go through this next season. And as we anticipate these changes, we need to stay flexible. We need to be ready for what comes next. And there's an opportunity for all of us to come back to church, to join in to the work that God is doing, to participate in the body. And maybe I say that and you're sitting at home right now, or you're sitting somewhere on your phone, or maybe you're listening to this driving in the car and you're thinking like, Wes, I'm by myself. I'm not able to do that right now. Well, that's okay. Right where you're at right now in this moment, with whatever you're bringing to this moment, God is with you. You've brought it to the right place. He wants to work in your life today. He wants to continue to center your life around Him. So let's come to Him together in prayer as we worship the Lord together. Would you pray with me? God, we are so grateful that You work in our lives. We are so thankful that You can work in us wherever we are. And we pray today that as we worship You, You would meet us, You would work in us, and You would change us. As we center our hearts on You, would You make us look more like You, Jesus? In Your name we pray. Amen.
Psalm 119, verses 57 through 64. Heth, the Lord is my portion. I promise to keep Your words. I entreat Your favor with all my heart. Be gracious to me according to Your promise. When I think on my ways, I turn my feet to Your testimonies. I hasten and do not delay to keep Your commandments. Though the cords of the wicked ensnare me, I do not forget Your law. At midnight, I rise to praise You because of Your righteous rules. I am a companion of all who fear You, of those who keep Your precepts. The earth, O Lord, is full of Your steadfast love. Teach me Your statutes.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robes as He walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He hears faith.
let our faith rise up this morning. Let's praise Him with all we have. Let's sing it again.
There is a sound I love to hear. It's the sound of the Savior's robes as He walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises. He hears faith. give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. And great are give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your
the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. And great are you, Lord.
If it's meaningful to you, I just want to invite us to raise our hands.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. And great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Man, that song is so powerful. To sing to ourselves and to God of His greatness. We were singing that song last Sunday at church, and And Pastor Zach was teaching us about God manifesting his presence to his people, and we felt that. It's incredible to be together, to hear the voices of God's people singing out his greatness. So I hope you'll come one of these Sundays, join us in person as we worship the Lord together. But our worship isn't only in our songs. Psalm 105 verse 1 says that we praise the Lord, that we proclaim his greatness, and we make his deeds known. So let's continue our worship now by offering God prayers of praise. Let's tell of his greatness. Let's make his deeds known as we lift up his work to him. Well, last week, Pastor Zach taught us from Joshua chapter 5 about God's presence in our lives, about his extraordinary work in our ordinary moments. And maybe right now feels like an ordinary moment for you. Maybe you're sitting on your couch or staring at your phone watching this. But God can do an extraordinary work when we turn to him, when we acknowledge him in all of our ways. So Pastor Zach's going to continue through the book of Joshua today, and we're expecting God to do great things.
Well, I imagine that every one of you knows what it feels like to have to change your plans. We probably all know the feeling of plans that have failed. After this past year, we're all getting really used to holding on to our plans pretty loosely. And while that's not a great feeling, I think in terms of our faith, it's a great opportunity, because if you've walked with the Lord for any amount of time, you've probably discovered that God's plans are very different than ours. And the more that we can learn to hold our plans with an open hand, the stronger our faith becomes. And by faith, we begin to see God do great things in our lives. Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9 says this, and this is God speaking to his people. He says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, and neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." And nowhere is this more obvious in the Bible, perhaps, than in the story of Joshua. And we're going to look at Joshua chapter 6, where we're going to watch as God calls his people to do something that would never be a part of any plan that they could come up with. It reminds me of what Hudson Taylor said when he said, you know, there's three ways that we can serve the Lord. Number one, we could make the best plan that we can and hope it succeeds. Number two, we can make the best plan that we can and pray that God blesses it. And number three, we can ask God for his plan and do what he says. Joshua and Israel are going to choose that third option, and they're going to get to see God do something great. So let's look together at Joshua chapter 6 right now. In verse 1, it says, now Jericho was shut up inside and outside because of the people of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand with its kings and mighty men of valor. You shall march around the city, all the men of war going around the city once. And thus you shall do for 6 days. 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the ark. And on the 7th day, you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. And when they make a blast, a long blast with the ram's horn, when you hear the sound of the trumpet, then all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat. And the people shall go up, and everyone straight before him. Just before we keep reading, as we hear the plan that God gives to Joshua, we recognize that this plan is something God's people would never have come up with. I mean, in terms of a battle strategy, this is crazy. This is not a plan that is being studied at West Point right now, because God's ways are not our ways. And that's really clear here. So let's keep reading. So verse 6, Joshua the son of Nun called the priests and said to them, take up the Ark of the Covenant and let 7 priests bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord. So now Joshua's going to begin to tell the people the plan that God gave to him. In verse 7, he said to the people, go forward, march around the city, and let the armed men pass on before the Ark of the Lord. And just as Joshua had commanded the people, the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord went forward, blowing the trumpets with the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord following them. And the armed men were walking before the priests who were blowing the trumpets, and the rear guard was walking after the Ark while the trumpets blew continually. But Joshua commanded the people, you shall not shout or make your voice heard, neither shall any word go out of your mouth until the day I tell you to shout, and then you shall shout. So he caused the Ark of the Lord to circle the city, going about it once. And they came into the camp and spent the night in the camp. Then Joshua rose early in the morning. The priest took up the Ark of the Lord, and the 7 priests bearing the 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord walked on, and they blew the trumpets continually. And the armed men were walking before them, and the rear guard was walking after the Ark of the Lord while the trumpets blew continually. And the 2nd day, they marched around the city once and returned into the camp. And so they did for 6 days. One of the things I want you to notice before we go any further is you get the sense that the people didn't know the full plan. The Lord tells Joshua, but Joshua seems to give it to them in steps. And the way this reads, Joshua is just telling them what to do step by step. Day one, here's what I want you to do. Go forward. And they come back. Day two, here's what I want you to do. And so they do that for 6 days. They're literally walking by faith, not knowing what's coming next. And even though Joshua knows, think of the faith that it would require for him to ask the people to do this. You know, you can imagine the response of the people. Wait, you want us to do what? How is this the plan of attack? And so Joshua, even though he knew the plan, would have to trust that the Lord really would come through. See, both for him and the people, it's all on the line in this moment. Let's keep reading. Verse 15, on the 7th day, now something's going to shift. They rose early at the dawn of the day, and they marched around the city in the same manner, but now 7 times instead of just once. It was only on that day that they marched around the city 7 times. Verse 16, at the 7th time when the priests had blown the trumpets, Joshua said to the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the city, and the city and all that is within it shall be devoted to the Lord for destruction. Only Rahab the prostitute and all who are with her in her house shall live, because she hid the messengers whom we sent. But you keep yourselves from the things devoted to destruction, lest when you have devoted them, you take any of the devoted things and make the camp of Israel a thing for destruction and bring trouble upon it. But all silver and gold and every vessel of bronze and iron are holy to the Lord. They shall go into the treasury of the Lord." And so the people shouted and the trumpets were blown. And as soon as the people heard the sound of the trumpet, the people shouted a great shout, and the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they captured the city. Then they devoted all in the city to destruction, both men and women, young and old, oxen, sheep, and donkeys, with the edge of the sword. Now, this is the story of a great victory that God gives to his people according to his promise and his plan. But sometimes when we read this with modern eyes and minds, these are difficult verses for us to understand, because we live in different days in the safety of suburban life, so to speak. But have you ever wondered, when you think about the story, why God would implement a plan that took 7 days? Why this procession, and why all of the to-do? And certainly there's more than one answer, but one of them that I want you to consider before we go any further is God's mercy. God was giving the people in the city 7 days to turn to him. And it wasn't just that he gave them 7 days. Prior to that, he had given them 40 years. Because early on in the book of Joshua, remember, we read that the people had heard about the victories that the God of Israel had given his people, and their hearts were melting for fear. That's why that when the spies came to Jericho the first time, Rahab was all ready to express her faith and loyalty to the God of Israel, because she has heard of what he's done. And so she turns, and her whole family is saved. So why the 7 days? Why the 40 years? Because God is mercifully giving people a chance to turn to him. And it's not just 7 days or 40 years. Get this. God gave these people 400 years. All the way back in Genesis chapter 15, when God initially makes his covenant with Abraham about his descendants that would become a great nation, whom he would give to them the land. Listen to the words that God speaks to Abraham in Genesis 15, verse 13. "Then the Lord said to Abraham, 'Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and will be servants there. And they will be afflicted for 400 years. That's speaking of their time in Egypt. But I will bring judgment on the nation they serve, and afterward they shall come out with great possessions. As for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace. You shall be buried in a good old age, and they shall come back here in the fourth generation, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete.'" So God is saying to Abraham, "I'm making this promise. I'm going to give your descendants this land, but it's going to take four generations, 400 years, for this plan to unfold." Why? Because the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. God is merciful and patient in the time that he gives those who are opposed to him to turn to him. And so when we come to this story, understand it in the context of that history. Understand that God is giving these people a way of escape. They could have surrendered to the true and living God and been welcomed in like Rahab and her family were, because that's exactly how the chapter ends. Look at verse 22. "The two men who had spied out the land, Joshua said to them, 'Go into the prostitute's house and bring out from there the woman and all who belonged to her, as you swore to her.' And so the young men who had been spies went in and brought out Rahab and her father and mother and brothers and all who belonged to her. They brought out all her relatives, and they put them outside the camp of Israel, and they burned the city with fire and everything in it, only the silver and gold and the vessels of bronze and of iron they put into the treasury of the house of the Lord. But Rahab the prostitute and her father's household and all who belonged to her, Joshua saved alive. And she has lived in Israel to this day because she hid the messengers whom Joshua sent to spy out Jericho. Joshua laid an oath on them at that time, saying, "Cursed before the Lord be the man who rises up and rebuilds this city, Jericho. At the cost of his firstborn shall he lay its foundation, and at the cost of his youngest son shall he set up its gates." And so the Lord was with Joshua, and his fame was in all the land. What a memorable story. What an incredible victory as God's people enter the land at Jericho. But as we look at these details and events, we wonder why this plan? What was God up to? What was he doing? And we realize, I think, that our plans are always about what we want to accomplish. But God's plans take into account who he wants us to become. See, God's plans are not just to get us from point A to point B. Those are the plans that we devise. What we can't figure out, because we don't have the wisdom, we don't have the power, we don't have the knowledge, we can't figure out the plan that gets us to the desired destination and changes us in the process. That's what God is able to do in his wisdom. We try to devise plans that we think are the most efficient, the least costly, and the most convenient and comfortable way of doing things. But when we put our plans up next to God's, they never compare. Let me show you what I mean. All of Israel's proposed plans in this situation would have taken longer, cost more, and could not guarantee success. What kinds of plans could Israel have come up with here? Well, it would have been typical in coming to a fortified city to try to dig a tunnel under the wall. That would be one proposal. Another proposal would be to build ladders or siege towers and try to go over the walls. Another proposal could have been, and was common in these times, to prepare a battering ram and try to break through the walls. Or another way of taking the city would be just to lay siege and starve them out, which would have taken a long time. Maybe they could have come up with some clever way of tricking those inhabitants at Jericho, like a Trojan horse or something. Maybe they could have figured out some tricky way to get into the city. But none of these were God's plan. Those would have been man's plans. None of them was guaranteed to succeed, and they all would have probably cost more lives and taken more time. And so when you look at this, you see that God's plan was not only about accomplishing the task, but changing his people in the process. God's plan is not to solve a problem as much as it is to save a people for himself. And that's what God's doing. But here's the incredible thing. The work of God, though it was never a plan that man would have ever come up with, the work of God was the most direct path in. It was the straightest way. True, they had to wait, but when the walls fell by God's power, that was the straightest path. They could walk right in. Notice that twice in verse 5 and verse 20 of chapter 6, it talks about how the people would go straight in. They didn't have to go under or over or through. The walls would fall and they could go directly in, which reminds us that even though God's plan might have looked like a divine detour, it was the most direct route, not just to victory, but to make his people who he wanted them to be. And that, I think, becomes one of the most important lessons of this passage for you and for me. As we try to learn from what's written here for us, what does it speak to us about? And what I want to suggest is that it speaks to us about being wholehearted people. Because if God's plan isn't just to accomplish the task, but to transform us, what is he changing us to be? What is he wanting us to become? God wants us to become wholehearted people. Listen to how the psalmist said it in Psalm 86, verse 11. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I love that phrase, unite my heart, because our hearts are so often divided. And God wants us to become wholehearted in our loyalty and dependence and trust in him. Jesus, you remember when he was asked what the greatest commandment is, what is it that pleases God? He said, you shall love the Lord your God with what? All your heart. God wants us to become wholehearted people. And remember that Jesus went further. He said, I want you to love God with all your heart, which will enable and empower you to love your neighbor. Because that second commandment is like the first. It's linked with it. When we become the people that God wants us to be, it's seen in our love for the people that God wants us and has called us to love. It's such a good reminder for us here as we study the book of Joshua that we're not looking for a promised land. We're looking for a promised life. But over and over, we run into a problem when it comes to living and loving wholeheartedly, the life that God wants us to live. See, the holes in our hearts and the wounds that we carry, the people who have hurt us and the people that we've hurt prevent us from living and loving wholeheartedly like God has called us to. Listen to what it says in Proverbs 18, verse 19. It says, a brother offended is more unyielding than a strong city, and quarreling is like the bars of a castle. So when we think of Jericho and this story with God's people, and when we think of our own lives, we realize for us it isn't physical walls or city. It isn't a battle with flesh and blood, but it's a fight for our own heart to love God and for the souls of the people that we love to see God and be saved. That's the battle we're in. The fight to love our neighbor. The fight to love our family, and even the fight to love our enemies, because this is the life that God has called us to. Maybe it isn't, like it says in Proverbs, a brother, but maybe it's a parent or a friend, or maybe it's a sibling or a coworker, or maybe it's your spouse. Maybe there's a situation where there's been an offense, and that offense has become a wall that separates, and you've walked around and you've tried everything you know how to reach to them, and you wonder, what will it take? And I think there's three things that I want to encourage our hearts with today in fighting the good fight of faith, to becoming wholehearted people. The first thing I want to encourage you with, whatever walls you're facing, with whatever separation you feel, I want to encourage you right now, wherever you are, to surrender. See, the story of Joshua 6 starts in Joshua 5. Yes, it's a great victory, but it's one that starts in surrender. When Joshua asks the Lord, who appears to him, whose side are you on? That was an important question, but it wasn't the key question. The key question comes right after that in Joshua 5, verse 14, where Joshua says, and what does my Lord say to his servant? That's surrender. First, Joshua is trying to figure out sides and who's right and who's wrong. It's an us against them mentality. But when he sees the Lord, he surrenders. He knows there's only one side. And that's with the Lord. And so here's the key question. He says, what do you say, Lord? What do you say to your servant? That's me. That's the place that we want to be. There are no sides. It's not us against them. There is only the Lord's side, and it only matters what he says. And all of our competing plans and conflicting thoughts and strategies will just confuse us and make things worse until we surrender to him. Are you in a place today where you can say, what do you say, Lord? I'm done trying to figure it out on my own. I'm done trying to get my own way or manipulate the situation. I want to surrender to you today. What do you say, Lord? See, we are made whole when we come to him, when we surrender to him, when there's only his side. Otherwise, we'll be choosing between this plan and that, this side and that. No, it's what do you say, Lord? That's wholeheartedness, to surrender to him. Well, not only surrender, but I want to encourage us to stay. What do I mean by stay? Well, for 6 days, Israel marched around the city and saw nothing. I imagine they were human like we are. The first day they set out and they're like, here we go. We've been given the plan. It's a little weird, but we're going to do it. And nothing. They went back to camp for the night. Joshua wakes them up, sends them out again. Okay, that was a little strange, and maybe that was just a warm-up, and here we go, and nothing again. And sometimes I don't think we put ourselves in the story properly and relating in our own lives to how impatient we become with God's work. 6 days of doing this with the enemy staring down on them from the walls. At some point, the excitement would have become nerve-wracking. Is this going to do anything? What are we doing out here? At some point, their enthusiasm would have turned to insecurity, wondering. But we remember, don't we, in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 12, how we're told that it's by faith and patience that we inherit the promise. Can you imagine if they would have quit on day 6? They would have gone back to the camp demoralized, feeling stupid, and say, you know what, I'm not doing that anymore. This is dumb. How many times have you and I quit and missed the work of God? See, to see God work requires patience to see it through. And I've noticed that sometimes I try to use faith as an excuse to not have patience. I try to use faith as a way of saying, I don't want to wait anymore, so I'm going to do something brash and I'm going to call it faith, when really it's just me getting ahead of God and not wanting to wait. And see, if my commitment is half-hearted, that will always eventually be exposed. God's plan never allows for half-heartedness. We have to be all in to the end. Day 4, day 5, day 6. Day 7, keep going, stay in. God's gonna work. It might be 6 days, it might be 6 months, it might be 6 years. Stay in it, because the Lord is going to work. And wholeheartedness in faith as we follow him is what pleases God and what allows us to watch him work in our lives. Well, finally, they shout. And this might seem like a strange application for us in our day. Okay, well, yeah, that's what they were called to do. But what does that mean for us? And I think it's simple, but it could be powerful in our lives to remember that a shout is something you can't fake. You have to go all in. I remember several years ago when my son was young, he was taking Taekwondo, and the instructor was trying to teach them how to yell when you do a move, because that's supposed to help you do the move better. I forget what they called it. There's a word for it. But the kids were kind of doing it half-hearted, and they were a little bit self-conscious, and they weren't doing it. So he says, no, you guys aren't doing this right. And the parents were there in the stands, and he's like, I'm going to call one of your parents to show you how to do this. And he's like, you. And he points at me. I'm like, oh, no. He's like, you're going to show these kids stand up. And I'm like, oh, my gosh. Feeling totally insecure, totally self-conscious. And he's like, all right, I want you to yell, like throw a punch and yell as loud as you can. And I was so in my head and so embarrassed that it came out like, My son was so embarrassed. I did it in front of all the parents and all the kids. And the instructor's like, that's not quite what I was looking for. It's a silly illustration, but the point is you can never shout half-heartedly. To give a shout takes your whole heart. And notice, here's the interesting thing to me. The Israelites were told to shout before the walls fell. It's one thing when you see the walls fall to go, whoa, you know, here we go. It's totally something else to shout in faith before the walls fall. That's wholeheartedness. And I think, you know, I want to encourage us, church, if we want to see God move, we have to get rid of this hesitation. We have to stop worrying about what we look like or what people would think. We have to remove all our fear and doubt and lift up a shout of faith. It says in Psalm 47, verse 1, clap your hands, all you people, shout to God with loud songs of joy. Sometimes I think our faith and our worship is so safe and it's so proper and it's so put together, but it's not wholehearted. And so I want to encourage us today to shout to the Lord, to pour out our hearts to Him, to, in faith, surrender to Him and stay in the fight and shout out His praise. Church, God is working. Even when you don't see it, even when you can't feel it. And so surrender to Him today. Stay in it. Keep moving forward by faith and lift up a shout of praise to God. Let's pray right now. God, I want to pray that the walls that are in front of us, the walls that are between us, Lord, would come down. That, Lord, you would work in mighty ways in our lives and in your people. Lord, I pray that where there are divisions, you would bring reconciliation. I pray that where there is separation, Lord, you would bring healing. Lord, I pray that where there is half-heartedness in us, Lord, you would make us wholehearted people. And I pray, Lord, that we would surrender to your plan, not just to get the task done, but to be changed in the process. And so, God, right here in this place, we worship you. We lift up a shout of praise, Lord. We turn to you, and we want to see you move, Lord. So we ask that you would, in Jesus' name, amen.
Where will you run, my soul? Where will you go when wells run dry? When the wind starts to blow, how you gonna keep this flame alive? In the fading light, when night is breaking, I know you will always be waiting. You'll always be there. I'm running to the secret place where you are, where you I'll sing to you of all the ways you stole my heart, stole my heart. Better is a moment that I spend with you than a million other days away. I'm running to the secret place. You are my only hope. You are the rock on which I stand. not let me go. I know that I'm safe inside your hands. In the fading light when night is breaking, I know you will always be waiting. You'll always be there. I'm running to the secret place where you are. The secret place. Hands are lifted high, hearts awake to life. We are satisfied here with you, here with you. Chains will hit the floor, broken lives restored. Couldn't ask for more. Here with you, here with you. Hands are lifted high, hearts awake to life. We are satisfied. Here with you, here with you. Chains will hit the floor. Secret place where you are, where you are. I'll sing to you of all the ways you stole my heart, stole my heart. Better is a moment that I spend with you than a million other days away. I'm running, I'm running to the secret place. I'm running. I'm running to the secret place.
I want to encourage you, don't just hop off, don't skip to the end of the video. If you're with your church at home group, you can go through our prayer points together. You can get off. But if you're by yourself, stay with us. We want to pray together. We want to use these last few minutes of our time to come before the Lord. We're going to go through some prayer points. I'll lead you through them. Don't worry. We're in it together. Our very first prayer point is actually a really exciting one. We're going to continue praying for our missionary partners, Tim and Talisa Rogers. They have made it back to East Asia. We've been praying for them for a while. Through this past year, they had to come back to the States. They couldn't be on the mission field. And now they're back in the mission field. They're transitioning back into ministry. And so we want to lift up praise to God for the work that he's doing in them. Our second prayer point today is for our nation. We want to continue to ask God to help us be ambassadors of reconciliation. We want to make a habit of lifting up our nation to God in prayer, asking for his blessing, asking for his grace to be poured out on the United States. Our third prayer point is for our Church of the Week. And this week, the Church of the Week is Petaluma Valley Baptist Church and Pastor Alan Cross. Let's lift them up to God in the work that they're doing. They're still meeting outside. They're trying to serve their church community. So let's ask God for strength, and let's ask His Spirit to meet with them today. And lastly, we want to lift up our personal prayers to God. And if you're joining us for church online, type those prayers into the chat. We'd love to pray with you. And if you're watching this by yourself and you're saying, oh, Wes, I'm not connected. What do I pray by myself? God hears your prayers right where you're at today. But I want you to know that we would love to pray with you. If you reach out to us on social media or send an email or give the church office a phone call, we'd love to know what's going on in your life. We would love to pray with you and help you connect in. So let's lift up our personal prayers to God.
Well, we're really excited about the changes ahead and the direction that things are moving. We're coming back to church March 14th. We're going to begin adding back in children's ministry. And so there will be some changes even to church online and church at home. But one of the things we never want to change is our desire to respond to God's word. We don't just want to hear God's word, but we want to respond. And so this application question will continue to be a part of our service. And the way that I want to challenge you this week with God's word, we always want to be saying, God, give me ears to hear what your Spirit is speaking. We want to hear what God's speaking to us. And so I want to ask you, how do you serve the Lord? Remember what Hudson Taylor said, do you usually make the best plan you can and hope it succeeds? Do you make the best plan you can and pray that God blesses your plan? Or do you ask God for His plan and do what He says? I want to challenge you to pray what Joshua said in Joshua chapter 5 when he said, Lord, what are you saying to your servant? And ask the Lord to speak to you directly about the walls that are in front of you, about the challenges that you're facing, and ask that God would give you His plan and the courage and faith to walk in obedience and to see Him do a great work.
Thank you so much for joining us today. As we go into this week, let's seek to wait on the Lord. Let's acknowledge Him in all of our ways, and let's walk in the path that He puts before us. As we go into this week, if God is moving in your heart, if you're ready to take a step of faith, we'd love to hear about that. Please text CCP NEXT to the number 94,000. We would love to hear about what God's doing in your life. We'd love to connect with you. We'd love to pray with you and encourage you in your faith. Well, church, this is it. You made it to the end. Go into your week. Go with the presence of God. Walk in the paths that He has set before you. God bless you, church.